In his 2002 novel, The Yacoubian Building, Alaa al Aswany used the fictional residence of a single building in Cairo to paint a loving but critical portrait of modern-day Egypt. The book became a huge bestseller in the Arab world and, translated into 22 languages, gained much attention and readership beyond, including here in the U.S. His new novel, Chicago, just released in English, again explores the lives of Egyptians, but this time a group studying and working on a college campus in post-9/11 America. Alaa al Aswany himself studied dentistry at the University of Illinois in the 1980s and continues his dental practice part-time now in Cairo. Welcome to you.
Thank you.
I gather this book is based partly on your own experience, but it's set after 9/11. What were you trying to do?
Usually the novelist is using his human experience in the sense that usually any novelist is writing about what he knew and what he lived. But this does not mean that it's an autobiography, because this is different. So I did study in Chicago, and I did study in the University of Illinois, and I had from the very, very first day in Chicago this idea that to keep my eyes open and to try to understand what's happening in Chicago and with the Egyptian immigrants and with even some American people, I said to myself, this is a rich experience, and probably one day I could write a novel about this experience.
And then when you said it after 9/11, of course, it is fraught with all the tensions after that period. I mean, one way to look at the theme here is a kind of clash of cultures, obviously.
Yes, but I think personally that 9/11 did not create new problems. It just pushed chronic problems to be on the surface, you see. We had before 9/11 this kind of, you see, misunderstanding between cultures and different people and stereotypes, etc. But now it is pushed on the surface. And I believe that literature has been all the time a wonderful tool to get rid of the stereotypes and to get close to realities. Mm-hmm. And that's exactly what I tried to present in Chicago.
You've said that your 3 years that you spent here in the U.S. in Chicago were an incredibly important period for you.
Of course.
In writing about the United States now in this new novel,
yes,
for your readers back home,
yes,
what do you think is not well understood about the United States?
Well, the most important thing that was really surprising for me when I first came here, that the big distance between the nice American people who are very helpful, very broad-minded, very supportive, and the American foreign policy, you see. I had the impression that the American foreign policy was decided in another country, you see. Mm. Because the people were not simply caring about the American foreign policy, and they didn't realize how the American foreign policy was really very harmful to many countries all over the world, not only for Egypt or for the Arab world. And I believe this is something that not many people know abroad.
What do you think that, from your experience here in the United States, that we don't understand about Egypt and Arab culture right now?
Well, I think that, I think that it is not that you do not understand. I think that we must get closer in the sense that in the education and in the media, what is happening abroad, you see, is not really very essential in America.
In the United States.
In the United States, you see. And I think that this is to be changed, because the America is a very great country, and you decide not only about what's happening in the U.S., but what's happening in the world. So I think that it's about time for Americans really to get the opportunity, because they are not to blame, to get the opportunity to know more about the world.
Finally, I just want to ask you, I mentioned that you still work part-time as a dentist, right?
Yes.
And I understand that you see your work as a way of connecting to real life still and to people. I mean,
yes,
is there a connection between The work as a dentist and the work as a novelist?
Yes, of course. If you take dentistry as a part of, which is the case, as a medical profession, then I would say that medicine has given much more writers, fiction writers, than any other profession. You had Emile Zola in France, Somerset Maugham in England, Anton Chekhov in Russia. And to me, it
and
makes sense.
We had the great poet, William Carlos Williams.
Yes, William Carlos. You see, I think it makes sense because both literature and medicine are dealing with the same topic, with the human being and the human pain. Medicine is trying to cure the human pain, and literature is trying to understand, analyze, and explain the human pain. So I think they are both two aspects of one single profession.
So you're going to continue to write and continue to practice dentistry?
Yes.
All right, the new novel is Chicago, Alaa al Aswany. Thank you very much.
Thank you. How would Shaima Mohammadi know all this history, having spent all her life in the Egyptian city, Tanta, which she rarely left other than to attend a relative's wedding or to go to Alexandria and spend the summer with her family as a young girl? Shaima came from Tanta to Chicago in one fell swoop without preparation or preliminaries, like one who, not knowing how to swim, jumped into the sea fully dressed. Anyone who saw her roaming the hallways of the medical school at the University of Illinois in her loose Sharia-dictated garb, the veil covering her chest, her low-heeled shoes and white, straightforward strides, her rustic face unadorned by any makeup, turning red for the slightest reason, and her faltering, heavily accented English, which made communicating by gestures easier than speaking, must have wondered, what brought this girl to America? There are numerous reasons. First, Shaima Mohammadi is one of the most accomplished and highest-ranked graduates in the Tanta College of Medicine. She is extraordinarily intelligent and has a legendary capacity for work, which makes her devote long, continuous hours to studying without sleeping or getting up except to perform her prayers, eat, or go to the bathroom. She studies in a calm manner and with deep concentration, without haste or impatience. She spreads the books and notes on the bed, crosses her legs, and tilts her head to a little to the right, letting her soft hair cascade down the side of her head. Then she bends, and in her beautiful, fine handwriting, she writes down the main points of the lesson and proceeds to memorize them. She savors that, as though indulging in a favorite hobby or weaving a garment for a faraway lover. Her unmatched distinction in her studies easily earned her an official Egyptian government scholarship.